I just celebrated my 2-year wedding anniversary not too long ago. Yeah. You could clap. I like him. I appreciate those of y'all who held your applause to make sure I was happy first. I was like, huh? Oh, she good. She good. I got a good one. I married a good dude. I got me a 1978 Caucasian. My husband's white. That's what I'm trying to tell y'all. He's not just white. He is Midwest white. Yeah, that's right. That's organic, girl. That is... Whew. That is farm to table white, y'all. Like that. I went to the source to get my white man. I am not white. I am Puerto Rican, which, Thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you, probably my cousins. You know how we get around. My husband loves the fact that he's married a sassy Latina. He loves to bring it up in conversation when it has nothing to do with what we're talking about. We're like, hey guys, my wife's Puerto Rican. Enjoy your meal. I get it. I mean, he's excited. I'm the only Latin woman he's ever been with, so I'm his first. He's not my first white guy. I've been with white guys before. Mainly to get information and take it back to my people. I like how most of y'all laughed. Some of y'all were like, I knew it. I knew that was their plans for world domination. First white guy I dated was years ago. He took me to his parents' lake house, and I was like, oh. Because that's when I found out white people buy houses that they don't live in. I was like, that's money, money. How many sub-houses do y'all have? They had fancy food at the lake house. I remember this because I was traumatized. Because I wasn't used to that, so I kept messing up and eating the decorations, thinking they were part of the food. Because fancy food is food that's decorated with other food. And then you gotta figure out what part of that you're supposed to eat. That's the game. We've all been through it, right? You go to a posh restaurant, you order what you think is an adult-sized meal. And they come at you with a shrimp on a spinach leaf and a radish shaped like a rose. That's what they had at the lake house. I ate the whole thing. Here's a pro tip. If you eat the whole thing, your boyfriend's parents will talk to you like you're an idiot the whole night. I ate it, whole thing, and they were like, the radish was the garnish. Can you say garnish? I was like, garnish? Ain't that a Hindu god? I grew up broke, man. We don't know nothing about no garnishes. Not unless you're talking about our wages. Some of y'all remember some bills you gotta pay right now. What's going through your head right now? When I say I grew up broke, I can always feel the rich people in the room's hearts break. Whenever I say it, they're always like, oh! You didn't even have a little bit of a lot of money? How did you live? I didn't know we were broke, man. I didn't know we were broke until I was about like 13. That's when the reveal happened. Because I volunteered at a neighborhood food drive and one of the bags was for my family. Imagine my surprise. I showed up, I was like, who are we helping today? They're like, help yourself, Gina. Grab a bag, get out of here. We had a good time growing up though, man. We always had a lot of dogs in my house because my grandmother would always pick up stray dogs, which became my attitude towards men. That's right. I see some guy wandering the street. I'm like, are you lost, buddy? Huh? Are you lost? You want to come home with me? Huh? I have bacon at my house. We fed our dogs rice and beans just like us. The dogs would look at us like, damn, are we broke too? Like, what's going on? I don't know, this situation. One thing was great, we had to be creative. Like me and my siblings, when we would play games, we had to play broke people games. Yeah, I see some of y'all chuckling. You guys know exactly what I'm talking about. Broke people games are games that don't require toys or money. You just had to be creative. Right, like we had this one game we used to play called Adventure. It was just us walking around a tree. You had to hold on to the tree because if your foot touched the floor, you were out. That was the adventure part. Played another game called Paperball. You crumble up a paper, you throw it to somebody, you got to keep it in the air because if it hits the floor, you're out. The floor was an integral part of many broke people games. Which is why The Floor is Lava is a historically broke person game. Some of these games are passed down from broke generation to broke generation. The Floor is Lava is one of those games. If you played The Floor is Lava and you had money, you were appropriating broke culture, and we don't appreciate that. Uh-uh. Go to a theme park. You got the money. Why you gotta take from us? We weren't broke forever. I feel like people always panic when I say that we were broke. We weren't broke forever. My parents are Latinos. They worked really hard to get us out of that situation. You know, we went from broke to, okay, we doing all right. To, oh, we got some money now. Then back down to, okay, we doing all right. Because when broke people get money, they don't know what to spend it on. You spend it on your fantasies. We got a little bit of money, and my dad bought a boat. We lived in the South Bronx. Where shall we sail, Papa? Shall we follow the pissy smell to the Isle of Manhattan? Let us away to sail. Don't get it twisted, man. I have nothing but respect for my parents. I love my parents, man. As I get older, I realize nobody teaches you how to be a parent. You gotta figure it out as you go along. The closest thing you get is when they used to give you like an egg to take care of for like a week in school. I mean, not in the schools I went to. I went to school in the Bronx, man. We just bought our actual babies. I was like, I don't need your egg. I bought my son. Like, matter of fact, give me that egg. I gotta feed my son. You made me wake him up. After that, I went to a school that was like majority white people. That's when I learned that I was dyslexic. Not from the teachers. They just thought I was writing in Spanish. They were like, don't correct her. It's her culture. I was so racially frustrated growing up because I'm Latina, but I'm light-skinned today. Yeah, so I always felt like I had to prove my ethnicity to people constantly. And I would do it in stupid ways, like throwing random Spanish words into sentences. I'd be like, okay, guys, see you at Escuela. Like some sort of live-action Dora. I just wanted to be identifiably ethnic. Like, I wanted to be darker. I wanted darker skin and a white boyfriend. Those were my only two goals. Because that's my parents' dynamic. Both of my parents are Puerto Rican, but my dad is light skin, and my mom has beautiful dark olive skin. And I would watch her put on her makeup, and she would wear purple eyeshadow and vibrant blushes, and I thought she looked beautiful, and then she would put that same makeup on me. And I look like a damn clown. And because of my light skin, people always tell me I look like my dad. But, oh, you look just like your father. I'd be like, great, he's a man. I want to look like my mom, she's a woman. always felt so terrible as a kid because I thought I looked like a guy, and now my voice is deep, so I always thought I sounded like a dude too. And plus, I'm Puerto Rican, but I speak Spanish with a Mexican accent. Yeah, I know. Because my friends were Mexican, I went to a Mexican church, I love tacos, that was another reason. Girl, yes. I'm learning French now. My biggest fear is I'm gonna speak French with a Mexican accent. Because that's the accent I'm most comfortable and confident in. But that's gonna be ridiculous if I'm like, orale, como se va? Eric's gonna be like, that poor French, Puerto Rican, Mexican girl. She is confused. The wrong accent can mess up the mood, right? Like, I downloaded a meditation to help with anxiety, and the guy doing the guided meditation had a Cockney British accent. I don't know if you've heard this, but it is not comforting. Like, I hit play, and he was like, hello, my name's Nigel. I'm here to help you with your anxiety. All right. Close your eyes. I will do no such thing, Nigel. I don't feel safe. We're gonna give thanks for everything. I'm always jealous of people with like awesome accents or tattoos. I saw this guy with a compass tattoo, and in the middle of the tattoo, it said, "You are here." I was intrigued. I was like, hey, what does your tattoo mean? And he was like, this? This is for like when I feel lost. I just look down. And I'm like, nah, bro. You're right here. Probably the best tattoo story I've ever heard. He asked me if I had tattoos. I was like, oh, I have stretch marks, which are nature's tattoos. Yeah, they signify that I like bread. That's what my tattoos mean. This one's red velvet. I got a couple of everything bagels right over here. Ain't no shame in my game. I love food. I'm not even gonna pretend like I don't. I love food too much. Too much. I walked into a store the other day, I saw my favorite pack of gummy bears, and I gasped like I saw a celebrity. That's too excited for gummy bears. Well, I try. Sometimes I'll see like a super skinny person, and I'll be like, hey, you look great. What do you eat? And it's always some depressing list of things. It's like, I eat lettuce and asparagus, and sometimes I eat an onion. I'm like, oh, so there's no hope is what you're saying. Because I'm not doing any of that. I always hope they have like some secret that I've never heard of. Like they're gonna be like, did you know if you eat a donut standing up, it's like half the calories? Thank you, you skinny angel. I try, man. I'm trying to be vegan now. I'm succeeding on Instagram. Killing it on the gram. Took a picture of a vegan brownie that I bought and I posted it and somebody commented, why do vegans always have to brag about being vegan? I was like, that brownie was $10. I'ma tell everybody about that brownie. I didn't eat it, I just been showing it to people that come over. Like, hey, look, this is what a $10 brownie looks like. Don't touch it, look at that. Get your non-vegan fingers away from here. I'm gonna make it into a necklace, wear it at weddings. You can recycle vegan food like that. It's hard, man, it's hard being vegan. It's not just no meat, it's no milk, no eggs, no honey. I did find out though, you could eat honey and still be vegan as long as nobody sees you. Just eat honey in the shadows, ain't nobody gonna care. So far, the vegan mafia has not caught on. I really wish they would. Oh, I'd love to meet the vegan mafia. They show up at my doorstep like, hey, I'm Tommy, no cheese. This is coconut milk Larry and agave Dave. We heard you been eating honey. We gotta have a word with you out back.
My friends don't even trust going out with me anymore. They won't eat out with me anymore because every time they go, now they do a check. They're like, is there gonna be real food there? I'm like, you guys didn't like those sawdust burritos we had last time. I thought those were delicious. The hardest was telling my family that I wasn't eating meat over the holidays. Trying to tell your Latino family that you don't eat meat, they don't get it. My mom was like, even chicken? Even steak? I was like, you know what? I'm gonna snort some quinoa and just call it a night, Ma. Like, you ain't gotta work this hard. My mom works so hard on the holidays too. She always starts cooking the night before. My husband gets all excited. He's always like, damn, your mom can cook. I'm like, well, it don't run in the family, so relax. We do creepy stuff. I'm gonna do creepy stuff, man. We'll go through your medicine cabinet. All right, you leave us alone in your room. We're going through that drawer. We're looking for clues, trying to figure out who you are. Men will go through drawers too, but they go right for the underwear drawer. They are not looking for clues. They will look past a human foot to see what kind of drawers you got in there. Like, is that a thong? This girl's a freak. Sometimes guys will sniff a girl's clothing. Women don't do that. That's a creepy thing women don't do. We don't do that. The only time we sniff your clothing is if there's a problem. Like, I'll be like, oh, you gotta wash that, bro. Like, that's nasty. Like, I'm just trying to help you out. That's gross. But if a girl likes you enough, if she goes through your drawers, if she finds something suspect, she'll make excuses. If she likes you enough, she'll find your antipsychotic meds and be like, at least he's trying to get help. He's just trying to help himself. Because men will see red flags and they'll be like, I'm out. A woman will see red flags and she's like, ooh, a project. He don't need these pills, he just need a hug. I'm gonna give him all the hugs his crazy self needs. So I did, I stalked my husband, right? I found out his schedule. I would try to show up looking all fly. All right, one time I looked real cute. I was like, he's totally gonna flirt with me. I look adorable. He didn't, so. But then one night after a show, he came up to me and he was like, I just got to see you perform. I think you're so talented. I think you're so funny. And you're the most beautiful female comedian I've ever seen. And I went, that's very specific, but thank you. Could have just said beautiful. I would have been fine with it. And then we talked for hours, and then we went back to his cabin, and I was like, oh, I'm gonna get my homint. That's a home moment, y'all can take that home with you. And then we got married. We did it, we made it happen. Yeah.
Yeah. It can happen for you too. You just gotta wanna be a hoe.
It. Just own it. I was nervous to get married because my husband wanted us to write our own wedding vows, which, like, you know, because he has feelings. I don't know how to express myself. I was so nervous my wedding vows were going to be the most New York gangster vows. I was so afraid I was going to get up there and be like, yo, I dead ass love you, son. Yo. God, I love you, my guy. And then we just chest bump. I'm like, let's do this. The priest is like, you may now dap the bride. I'm like, facts. Me and the bridal party gotta jump him into the marriage after that. Couple gangsters. Now that I'm married, I'm constantly on guard because I'm a jealous woman. I'm not gonna lie, that's the biggest issue he has to deal with. I'm jealous, man. You would think it would chill out when I got married. Uh-uh, if you talk to my husband a second too long. I'm like, ah. I don't know what your game is with this flirty line of questioning, but I don't like it. I'll be taking over from now on. And yes, he will have fries. I see you. Oh, I see you. People get intrusive with their questions. They'll be like, oh my gosh, how tall is your husband? Husband height. What cologne does he wear? Scent of my husband. His favorite movies are Wedding Video. You can leave now. They don't tell you this, but when you get married to somebody, you marry the entire bibliography of their issues. And you marry their family who gave them those issues. Like, his mom never made him clean up his clothes as a kid. Guess whose problem that is now? My husband will leave little piles of clothing on the floor as if he was raptured out of our apartment. I'm like, were you never beaten as a child for this? We were clearly raised differently. I noticed one time he had an argument with his mom in front of me, and I was shocked because I didn't realize you could argue with your parents. Like, Latinos live in fear of our parents well into our early hundreds. Right? Like, I'm trying to argue. I love life. He saw how shocked I was. He was like, don't worry, I would never talk to you like that. And I was like, I don't suggest it. You're a sound sleeper. Why do I know this? When you get married, you gotta get used to somebody being in your space all the time. Like when I was single, I woke up alone a lot. Now every time I wake up, I'm like, ah! Oh, it's you. It's like 100 times in a row. And maybe you can get a hobby or something. I don't know. Surprise me once in a while. Everybody wants to give you marriage advice when you get married. Some of it's helpful. Most of it's trash. Because they don't know how your relationship works. But everybody wants to guide you. One of my girlfriends told me, if your husband acts up, just withhold sex. And I was like, what did I do? That punishment affects both of us. I don't like your methods. Don't go to sleep angry, that's another one. I go to sleep angry all the time. Because he falls asleep before me and I'm just like, oh, you got nothing to overthink right now? Okay, okay. I had to get used to being responsible to another person too. That was hard, man. When my husband asked me if I paid my credit card bill, I gotta stop myself from being like, none of your business, bro. Cause then I remember like, oh yeah, it is his business. And no. I'm excited for you to be here. Thank you for coming to El Museo del Barrio. I love that we're here in this historic place. And it was so important to me to do this special in New York. Yeah. I love this city. Like, I love this city. I'm a native New Yorker. I'm born and raised here. And when you're born and raised in New York, you know New York ain't for everybody. That's how we like it. We don't want anybody just rolling up in here. Right, because people come to New York and then they complain about being in New York. And we're like, then go. Yeah. We did not request your presence. You just showed up. And they walk around the city complaining about everything. Like, New York is so gross. New York is so gross. I'm like, really? People don't openly poop in the streets where you come from? Well, then where you live is lame. Spice it up.
Are you guys, seem so ready. Are you guys ready to receive comedy? Thank you. I always feel like I need to poll the audience now because there's so much sensitivity. I feel like I have to be like, are you guys in a safe space for some jokes? Can you guys forget your trauma for a few minutes while I tell you about mine? I try to be sensitive to everything, but I'm losing myself in this PC world of being so correct. I don't know what to call people anymore. Like, I don't know what to call my garbage man. A garbage person? That seems harsh. Like, if somebody were to tell me I'm a garbage person, I'd be like, no, you have such a good heart. Why would you say that? You're so fun and so kind. They're like, no, Gina, I pick up trash for a living. You're an Uber driver? That's crazy. I take Uber too, I'm trash too. I do. My favorite new game is lying to Uber drivers about what I do for a living. Because I used to stupidly tell them the truth. I tell them I'm a comedian, and then they'd be like, say something funny. But when I tell them I'm a stripper, no more questions. You don't want to know about my relationship with my father? Seems like an obvious line of questioning. Last time I got in the car, the guy asked me what I did for a living. I was like, sir, I'm not at liberty to discuss that. Please keep your eyes on the road. And then I just started wiping my fingerprints off of everything. He was so scared. Like I said, I'm a native New Yorker. I'm born and raised in the South Bronx in New York. Yeah, I see you. Greetings, gangsters. A hearty year to all of you. Being from the Bronx, there's always gonna be like a hood side to me. Like, there's always gonna be hood in me. Like, there's hood me, and then there's evolved me. But hood me's still there. Like, evolved me knows that hurt people hurt people. But hood me just wants to hurt people. She don't care about your backstory. They're constantly battling for control. Like, hood me and evolved me. I gotta leave hood me repressed. I keep her repressed until I get angry. That's when the hood spirit inhabits my body against my will. And I can't control what happens. And it scares people because they don't expect it from me. It scares my husband. It do. Because I'll be like, honey, can you take out the garbage? And if he says the wrong thing, I'll be like, oh, word? We fighting now? Okay, you know what? I'm gonna calm down before I key our car. Say I won't. Wish you would say I won't. That's why I gotta let evolved me run the show. She's gotta navigate through the non-hood world. Cause sometimes you'll wanna handle something like you would on the block, right? Cause I'll be like, on my block, this will be a fight. But I can't beat you down in a boardroom. So now I gotta figure a way to verbally beat you down. You know, still sound intelligent, not use the F word. I gotta Rubik's Cube some words together. Like, I don't mean to be offensive, but I'm not trying to hurt your feelings. All because I cannot take the "are you stupid" out of my tone. It's such a struggle. It really is. It is such a struggle. No matter what I say, if I don't like you, I can say good morning and you'll be like, what the hell did you just say to me? I'll be like, I said good morning. Honey, call the police.
By the way, when I say I'm hood, I'm not Cardi B hood. I'm like Drake hood. Like, I'm not dangerous, but I will be the scariest person in Canada.